now discuss about the concept of mental health from an Ayurvedic perspective. Mental health, many of us may not have realized this, is becoming a leading cause of global ill health. India is not also, you know, in good shape as far as mental health is concerned. The predictions are quite frightening. One in four people in the world are expected to be affected by mental or neurological disorders at some point in their lives. If you look at numbers, at least 450 million people are suffering from, you know, serious mental disorders, and it is becoming one of the leading causes of disability and ill health worldwide. The thing is, problem about mental health is, unlike physical health, this is something which is, you know, comparatively invisible, and for that reason we may not even recognize and understand that you know, it's taking a big toll on the productivity of human lives. So I just want to emphasize the gravity of the situation before we go into the topic. So let's look at some more numbers. It has been understood that even when treatments are available, nearly two-thirds of people with mental disorders never seek professional help. This is a very serious problem. I mean, two-thirds of people who are mentally sick do not access, you know, medical care. So this is because of stigma, discrimination, and neglect. So this is all considered to be a bigger problem than the disease itself. So it has been clearly understood and emphasized that when it comes to mental health, this institutionalized formal care is not really the ideal methodology. I mean, it is much more kind of prohibitive, and also making the patient more uncomfortable that they are labeled as, you know, mentally ill person. We need to have more community-based mental health programs which are integrated even at primary health care levels. One of the biggest problems with mental health problems is that, you know, you get labeled the moment you go to a psychiatrist and an institution which is exclusively focused on mental disease. So one of the major things that we need to do is to bring this mental health into the primary health care level. I remember when I was a student of Ayurveda, I went to meet a traditional physician who was dealing exclusively with mental health. In Kerala alone, you know, the branch of Bhutavidya, interestingly, this is getting revived here in BHU, but in Kerala there is a living tradition of Bhutavidya, Manasa Chikitsa, in remote village in Kerala. And interestingly, that tradition was also established by a so-called lunatic. So he was called as Naranathu Brandan, means Naranath the lunatic. So it's an irony and a paradox that a tradition of mental illness was created by a person who was himself labeled as a lunatic. So here I'm stuck by this problem that even in modern society we are facing. The biggest challenge to mental health is the society itself. And this is what this physician told me, that it was very interesting. He said, in Ayurveda we have the Chatushpada, Bhishak Dravyani Upasada, Rogi Pada Chatushtaya. The Rogi is the fourth of the Chatushtaya, Pada Chatushtaya. But he said in mental disease, according to him, it is the society which is the fourth Pada. If you don't take society into account, if you don't treat or counsel the social, you know, environment of the person who has become mentally ill, you cannot completely rehabilitate. So one of the biggest problem, he said at that time, this was some decades ago, he had such foresight, he said the problem with dealing mental diseases in modern times is that we have a lot of management methods, but it all ends in labeling a person as mentally ill and never bringing them back, rehabilitating them and integrating them back into society never happens. And that's where he said that we need. So this is a very interesting concept that even in modern times, the WHO is emphasizing a community-based approach. which I first heard from a traditional, you know, Ayurvedic healing. So in Kerala, many of these, there were Ashtavaidyas and also Vaidyas specialized in Ashtangas. This makes Kerala quite unique. Ashtavaidyas were physicians who specialized in all eight branches at the same time. We could call it super specialization, or Ayurveda went beyond into super generalization. Because if you get specialized only in one branch, you become very narrow. So the physicians study Ayurveda first, then they specialize in one branch, then they are asked to get specialized in all eight branches also, so that they don't lose the perspective of the totality. At one point of time, I didn't know what the word Ashtavaidya means. I thought it was eight families, but then I came to know that there are 18 families. So it should have been Ashtadasha Vaidyas. But then one of the Ashtavaidya himself says that Ashtavaidya means one who knows all eight branches of Ayurveda. So this shows also that in Kerala at one point of time, Ayurveda became specialized and then went back into, you know, a specialized generalization. So this is a very interesting thing. And this is important historically, because if we did not have the examples of Vaidya specialized in individual branches, I mean, we could not have proposed this hypothesis. For example, we have Bala Vaidyas, we have Netra Vaidyas. Netra Vaidya again is a super specialization, because it means that apart from Chalakya had got further specialized, we had Vishavaidya. All of them are there in Kerala even up to modern times. And there is also for Manasa Roga a special tradition. This tradition was called as Punkudil Mana. So Vishavaidyas were specialized only in Vishavaidya. Then Ashtavaidyas are specialized in all eight branches. And then we have general physicians who knew only the basics of Ayurveda. So we had a three-tier structure of specialization and generalization in the history of Ayurveda in Kerala. So I'm just mentioning that incidentally, when you know, you look back and see the importance of this tradition of psychiatry in the classical tradition of Ayurveda. So the problem, another big problem, is that there is no mental health policy, no mental health program in most of the countries. So 40% of countries have no health, mental health policy at all, and 30 have no mental health program, and 25% countries have no mental health legislation. So this is a very serious problem. It's not just about, you know, creating a few clinics. I mean, we have to think very radically about how we need to change. And when it comes to budget also, it's extremely neglected. It's less than 1% of the total health budget is allocated for mental health. Many of the countries don't even have the common drugs. Of course, I don't say that all these patients should be drugged. And we are talking about an attitude and an approach. Definitely, we should have better alternatives than drugs for these problems. But the thing is, it's not given importance. It's a neglected area. There's only one psychiatrist per 100,000 people in half of the countries around the world. So if you have a mental problem, you cannot even access in healthcare professional. Perhaps it's good in one way, because too much of access to healthcare professionals a problem is also a problem, but the thing is, there's no alternative. And in many countries also, that there's only one hospital bed for, if you are mentally sick and you want to get admitted, then for 10,000 people you have only one bed which will be allocated if you're mentally sick. So we have completely focused, shifted our attention from the mind to the body. And this is, so we're talking about mental health because we need to completely reverse. You look at Ashtanga Hridayam, Ayurveda begins by saying Ragadi Rogan, that the whole cause of even physical malady is in the mind. So this is such a paradigm shift that we need today, which is why I'm also very interested in looking at mental health and how Ayurveda can contribute. So when we come into India, the problem, I mean, this is an invisible problem. Nobody talks about it, nobody recognizes it, but the problem is very much there. 42.5% of employees in the private sector in India suffer from depression or anxiety disorders. You cannot imagine how much it affects their productivity. I mean, a person cannot just function, you know, to their, even to a small percentage of their potential. And in India, with such a big population, we have so much of human resource. One of the reasons why we are not able to perform is that we are mentally debilitated. We are mentally compromised and handicapped. And that is why we are not able to bring up that efficiency. This definitely. So for all these reasons, I think there is such an importance to revive this branch dealing with mental health. We need an alternative model of the human mind and how we can interact with it, application-oriented approaches. And economic loss in India has also been calculated by the WHO, will amount to an estimated $1.3 trillion between 2012 and 2030. I mean, this gives us an idea of the magnitude of this problem. I mean, we are economically suffering at a time when our country is, you know, really aspiring to become an economic force in the world. And in spite of all these challenges, we are still, you know, leaping forward and becoming an economic force to reckon with. If we worked on the mental health of our people, you know, India would progress in leaps and bounds. So this is extremely, extremely important. And 36% of suicides globally happen in India. This is quite shocking. And when it converted into numbers, I mean, it's incomparable because of our population. A lot of people dying by suicide is from India. And the interesting thing is suicide has surpassed maternal mortality as the leading cause of death amongst women and teenage girls aged 15 to 19 years. So more women die by suicide today than by other causes of mortality in that age band. Now 7.5% of the country is seriously affected and less than 4,000 experts are available. And by 2020, which is now, the projection was that 20% of India, that is from 7.5 to 20%, will be suffering from some serious form of mental illness. So this is the background, and Ayurveda was one of the oldest medical systems to devote a branch exclusively for mental health. And even when you look at the definition of Kaya Chikitsa, Kaya definition includes Samana Sharira. The kaya is not just the body, it's always manas along with the sharira. So such a profound tradition, it's a shame that a country like India, let us forget about physical illnesses. I say that Ayurveda could be just used to improve the mental health of the people, we would make a huge contribution. Of course, psychology is considered as a soft science, that is why it is not glamorous, but it is very relevant socially. So definitely we should, so it's in this framework that I want to discuss about mental health. And what and how Ayurveda can actually contribute. So there are many common mental illnesses, frightening names like subclinical depression, dysthymia, anxiety disorders, generalized anxiety, panic disorders, phobia, social anxiety, OCD, PTSD, more severe illnesses like schizophrenia, schizoaffective disorders. Today, you ask and you can name it. I mean, the labeling of diseases has developed so much that, you know, we have very, very complex terms to describe almost anything that happens to our minds. And most of the time, this can give a very, you know, have a very, very negative effect on the people because you can now very easily label a person with a very specific disorder, say the bipolar disorder, hypomaniac, manic depressive, mix it. It's so sophisticated. So the thing is, as of now, WHO is really, it's good that WHO is now paying attention to mental health. But when it comes to solutions, I think that if what WHO is actually thinking will be implemented, it's going to actually add to the problem. Because if we give the responsibility of finding a solution to the psychiatrists around the world with its biomolecular, biomedical approach, then we are going to add to the problems because most of the time the treatments are more problematic than, I'm very much reminded also about cancer where, you know, treatment sometimes adds to the suffering. When it comes to mental health also, many of our available treatments, although in the short term, they can control certain types of behavior. In the long run, they can completely disintegrate a personality. It brings about a complete change of your person because in Ayurveda, we say that anything which is toxic, visham, creates vishada. One of the biggest side effects of many modern medicine is suicidal tendency, depression. Many modern medicines which we use for other conditions are also known to cause side effects in the mind, because they are poisons. Because the whole concept of a modern drug is to find that window between the therapeutic and the toxic dose. So they're all toxins being given in small doses. And if they are visha, they cause. We need medicines which produce ojas in the system. We need medicines which have the gunas of ojas, which are like amrita, which we need to transform the mind to a sattvic state. And this is where I think Ayurveda can play a key role. And we should not be just discussing about this as a philosophy, but we must create a theoretical and translational framework to start beginning to use this for the good of our people. So medications have side effects. They cause long-term dependence. And the more you use, the more you develop tolerance and loss of efficacy. The biggest problem with the current solutions, WHO says that there are medicines and people are not accessing it. But these are all being built on a reductionistic model of the mind. There is no mind. In the study of modern psychiatry, they are only studying the body, and they are actually working only on the body, you know, using these inhibitors, those, you know, antagonists, agonists. You're still just working on the body and not really looking at the mind. So this overemphasis on biomolecular, this is why I believe that we need an alternative model of the mind, and that's exactly what Ayurveda can offer. And a more comprehensive approach to understanding mental health and mental disease. So the biggest challenge with modern psychiatric approach is that it does not consider higher mental functionalities or even the spiritual dimensions of human personality. This is discussed a lot in psychology. We have happiness studies, we have ideas of well-being, but there's also a big gap between psychology and psychiatry, because psychiatry has come from medicine, biology. And psychology has been, you know, split and separated. So more of psychology should come into psychiatry and not more of, you know, pharmacology. This is a big thing. And so in Ayurveda, when we talk about mind, we are basically going to talk about a psychological approaches, what we would today classify as psychological and not purely psychiatric. I have always been intrigued by this term bhuta and graha, because we use this interchangeably. We say graha chikitsa or bhuta chikitsa. In fact, I think that if you put these two words together, we actually get a very simple meaning of what study of mental illness in Ayurveda means. Of course, the word bhuta has many, many meanings, but one of the simplest meaning is the past. So bhuta is that which has happened and which you cannot change. And graha means to be seized or caught. So my proposal is that bhuta, graha, if you put them together, is just being seized by your own past. And if you look at it really, all mental diseases originate in the trauma of an experience which you're not able to, you know, internalize and process. And so literally, in all mental illnesses, you're stuck in the past. And so all the healing is to enable you to process this encounter, a traumatic encounter which fixes you in the past. So any mental illnesses is a fixature in your past, and to depossess you. So it's the past that is possessing you. In fact, I know that I'm trying to rationalize and intellectualize. So I'm not saying that there are other implications or meanings, but I'm just trying to interpret another practical way of looking at this whole concept of Buddha Graha. Because if you, the moment you understand that it is, you know, a fixation on your past, and that the goal of the physician, even possession acquires a new meaning, because you can be possessed by your past. It is a kind of possession. And so you need to exercise your own past, and the change to your personality that past trauma or experience brings, which we call as the chidra or your vulnerability, which causes that traumatic experience to actually transform your personality, which is a way of coping with that experience. I mean, since you cannot internalize or overcome or what you can say process that experience, your response is by changing your personality. So by changing your personality, you are escaping, trying to escape from the trauma of your your past. And this is a very, very beautiful and profound way of even defining what is a mental illness. I think so. I always believed that, you know, there is more. The translations are what has completely destroyed Ayurveda. Now, people may ask me, how did you derive it? I said, I have not interpreted. I have only looked at the meaning of the words. And the meaning of the words convey something which makes sense and with which I can help my patients. So, what is wrong if I interpret Buddha Graha in this way? So, as long as I stick to the Sanskrit, then I don't need to give an English equivalent. If the moment I translate Buddha with their psychiatry or demonology, then the whole thing changes. So, this is the approach that I'm taking here to discuss about what Ayurveda means. And I think personality disorders, Ayurveda was one of the earliest systems to talk about shifts in personalities. You know, and that is why we had this concept of possession, that your personality is undergoing a radical transformation. And okay, so this is a very important aspect. And now let us look at mental health. The WHO defines mental health as a state of well-being. Now, they made it quite elaborate, in which the individual realizes his or her own abilities, can cope with the normal stresses of life, can work productively and fruitfully, and is able to make a contribution to his or her community. This is quite interesting because, you know, now you look at mental health in terms of how you express yourself, how productive you are in your life and how you contribute to society, how you are able to cope up with the experiences in your life. So this is where I think there is a lot of relevance for this interpretation of the word Bhuta and Graha, because coping is such a central concept in mental health now. How can you cope with a traumatic experience? How can you overcome it? How can you adjust to it? And I'm also reminded of a verse from the Bhagavad Gita which almost puts, you know, the highest state of spiritual achievement, which is a state of elevated mental health, of course, as the ability to cope even when you are confronted with, you know, a very strong trauma. Yasmin sthitona dukhena gurunapina vichalyate. Tam vidyad dukkha samyoga viyogam yoga samnitam. So this is very interesting. This idea of coping is there in our tradition. This is something which we should now try to translate and bring into the fabric of, you know, society. I mean, as an attitude, how do we preserve our mental health? It's by coping. How we face adverse and traumatic circumstances. So Bhagavad Gita says, how do you know if a person is mentally healthy? Yasmin sthito na dukkhena gurunapi na vichalyate. Even when you face a dukkha which is very guru. And that's why I say Bhuta Graha means you are being captured by a traumatic experience of your past. Tam vidya dukkha samyoga viyogam. So when you are not affected by an adverse situation, that's the real test of mental health. And it's very interesting that WHO has also incorporated this idea of coping with a stressful situation and still able to function productively for yourself and also for society. So this is a goal, this is a measure that we use, and if we apply this in actual life, India would become one of the most productive countries in the world. So the Ayurvedic, I would like to now propose that we need to know what is mental health, and I'm proposing an Ayurvedic model of the mind and mental health to start with, which we can use to, you know, think of new approaches for dealing with the problem in our own country. I think it will be a shame if, not only from Ayurveda, but from our deep spiritual traditions like the works of Patanjali, they are actually works on deep psychology. They're not religious texts. They're actually systematic accounts of human psychology, deep human psychology of the higher mental faculties. We have such a rich resource when it comes to the mind and spiritual faculties. I don't think there's any other culture or civilization in the world that has accumulated so much, you know, deep knowledge. And it is an irony that we are not able to apply it for the benefit of our own society. And in that regard, I must also mention, I will give some details towards the end of this talk, that there are initiatives in India. In fact, just now I saw, I'm part of some groups which are trying to, you know, develop a psychological approach inspired by Ayurveda and Indian traditions. There's actually a seminar that has been organized in Chennai where indigenous approach to mental health is the whole focus. So it's a welcome change. In Pondicherry, there is an institute called IPI, Indian Psychology Institute, where they are trying to, and the Dutch psychiatrist is actually leading this whole activity. I was part of a summit, Applied Indic Psychology Summit in Indian Institute of Science, you know, about 10 days ago, where a group of people from diverse fields came together and contemplated and discussed on how we could develop an Indian approach to, you know, solving the mental health problems of our own people in our own country, which is rooted in our own culture. It's much easier for them to relate to these concepts and then, you know, overcome them. So if you look at Ayurvedic definition of mental health, it is quite comprehensive. It's also very physical. This is what fascinated me. In fact, for Ayurveda, the mind and body is just part of one continuum. There is not a divide. So we could focus on both body and mind, you know, in a very balanced way. There is no split. It was the Cartesian split of mind and matter, which has created so much of problem and confusion in the modern thinking. They put the mind also before the self, because Descartes' famous statement is, I think, therefore I am. But from our tradition, it would be just the opposite. I am, therefore I think. So the self is the basis, that I am existing is the fundamental experience. Otherwise, I am created by my mind. My existence creates my thoughts. I am there. That is why I think. This shift is extremely important. And without this, we cannot dissociate from our mind. And the mind and the body in our tradition is one continuum. And we extend. So this idea of the human being as a tripod of the body, mind and self is central to Ayurveda. This awareness of a deeper aspect of our personality. I think this is what makes Ayurveda, we talk about person-centered medicine, but still we are stuck with the physical. How our physical body is different from one another. But that's not the whole point, because in Ayurveda, person-centered approach means to have a deeper understanding of your being. That your body is only the outer shell of a much deeper reality of your own self, which goes even beyond the mind into a state of, you know, self-generated bliss. I mean, if you are able to put your mind into the deeper core of your personality, I mean, you will realize that you are already in bliss. I was recently reading about a very interesting concept that our body has the receptors and the mechanisms to make a lot of chemicals that can keep us happy, which means we don't need to take these drugs from outside. In fact, there was one spiritual teacher who said, only foolish people take drugs to go on a high, because all these chemicals can be manufactured in your own body. You don't need to take cannabis. Your body can produce endocannabinoids, only if you know how. So there was a time when scientists discovered that there are endocannabinoids in the body, but they didn't know why it was there, because they couldn't find the chemicals. So it's interesting, because an Israeli scientist who discovered this endocannabinoid came to Aurobindo Ashram, and he had a premonition that he would be the person who would discover this endocannabinoid. And even before he found that chemical, he named it as anandamide. So this is one of the rare chemicals in the world which has a Sanskrit name. And it is no coincidence that our Shastra, which is based on the concept of Ananda, not even Sukha, because Sukha will come with Dukha. Sukha and Dukha come together. If you have Sukha, you will have Dukha. But Ananda is something which is going beyond Sukha and Dukha. And the chemical that produces that state of Ananda in your body is aptly named as Anandamide. 4 years later, even though so many scientists were working on this, many of us do not know that anandamide, this endocannabinoid, was named even before it was discovered, inspired by the visit to a spiritual ashram in India. And that scientist, eventually 4 years later, he himself discovered this endocannabinoid and he called it as Anandamayla. So our own body has the ability to create happiness, that happy, blissful state of mind where we are able to cope better. So unless there is an inner transformation, you cannot cope with, if you are not prepared to face life, if you don't have that ingredient, if you have not awakened that ingredients in you and created that state of mental well-being, you cannot face the situations in life. We are all today unprepared. I mean, we are living at a very sensory, sensual level that when we get deeply affected, we just crumble and break. And this is what Ayurveda is talking all about when we say the sattva guna has to be increased. We have a very clear model on how to create this situation where this inner happiness will be always, you know, present in a constant manner. So the first concept in Ayurveda, I'm just putting few points here which describes how Ayurveda looks at mental health. We have a model of the mind called the Trigunas, Sattva, Rajas and Tamas. Now this is, you know, creating a dynamic model of how your mind behaves and how you should be able to, you know, organize or balance it. So we have always said, I mean, Sattva, it does not mean that you would eliminate Rajas and Tamas because both are necessary. I always compare this to an automobile. Like if you are driving, of course, an automobile which is not automatic, manual transmission, you need the gas pedal, which is the accelerator, and then the brake and the clutch. Now this is how you work with your mind. The brake pedal is tamas, with which you stop your vehicle, and the gas pedal is the accelerator. Now these are two functions of your mind. You can become active or you can rest, and the mind is continuously jumping. But it is the clutch or the sattva with which you are actually able to regulate these two processes. So the whole idea is rajas and tamas becomes a dosha only when if the clutch system fails, then, you know, your vehicle is out of control. So, and of course, the auto transmission is when you become a yogi, when you have awakened your higher, it's like going into an automatic transmission. A yogi's life is like a cruise drive. I mean, his mind is completely elevated to a state where it is self-regulating and self-balancing. Now we have then the balance of the tridoshas. This is the most interesting part, kapha stabilizing vata and pitta. According to Ayurveda, stability of the body does bring stability of the mind. This is very interesting. Kapha should have been tamasic. But what is tamasic in the body is actually creating a sattvic impact. So when the body is grounded, that is when the mind becomes sattvic. So I was always intrigued when I read the Prakritis. Why is Kapha Prakriti said to be more sattvic and more calm, whereas, you know, Pitta and Vata Prakritis are more rajasic and disturbed? Should not be the other way around. Kapha Prakriti should be tamasic, but it is not. This is because of this clear understanding of how so by stabilizing the body, you are actually stabilizing the mind. So kapha is when, that is why we say pragradam tu balam shleshma, that the kapha which is shuddha is the bala of not only your body but also of your mind. So the balance of the trigunas, balance of the tridoshas, and using this I will try to later on, just in a short while, create a integrative psychosomatic model of the body which is corresponding to some very interesting findings in modern science. But I leave it at this juncture because there are a few more points to discuss before we come back to the trigunas and tridoshas. The next clear thing is well-developed prajna, dhi, dhriti and smriti, which we say is essential not only for mental but also for physical health. And it is a pity that these concepts have been religiously interpreted. Prajna Bharata means sin. You know, you have, it is not, there is no, that is why if you look at Sanskrit, prajna means, it is, you know, the faculty of intellect, three things actually, dhi, dhriti and smriti. And three things come together, we call it as prajna. And if you look at the Sanskrit, there is no room for any religious, superstitious interpretation. Because dhi means ability to discriminate and know what is good or bad for life. That is dhi. If you don't have that knowledge, I mean, you cannot, you know, act upon it. And also, Prajnaparadha means only when all the three faculties are together disturbed. Just because you have a wrong decision, unless you actually put it into action, it does not produce a result. So only when all the three things happen that it actually produces a negative result. So if you do not act upon what you know, so the function of dhi is to tell you what is good and what is bad, and dhriti is to make you choose what is good over what is bad. So that knowledge should be translated into action, and that is a function of dhriti. And smriti is also needed, because if you don't remember what is good and bad, you will never be able to take that decision when that moment comes. So living with awareness, that is all what prajna means. And if you don't live with awareness, then you will get disease. Even today when we have these infections and, you know, people do a lot of wrong things. I've seen people wearing a lot of sophisticated masks and struggling to breathe and actually accumulating all the germs inside the mask and throwing it very unsafely. This is prajnaparadha. Now this is something which can easily spread. So in every situation, understanding with dhi what is right and what is good and what is bad is the basis of good health. So this is such a practical, this is what I feel we must bring this knowledge to a translational practical level. And the best thing is to not translate in language, better to understand it from Ayurveda itself. So this is the dhi, dhriti, smriti. So a well-developed prajna creates not only physical but also mental health. And the next important thing is emotional stability. So one follows the other. If you need, if the only way you can cultivate prajna is by having emotional stability. That raga, dvesha, the raga, the disturbances. When there is an emotional turbulence in your mind, your intelligence is hijacked. So this is the exact mechanism of prajnaparadha that Ayurveda says. If you are not emotionally mature, you will never have prajna. Because whenever the prajna has to be exercised, you either you panic or you get emotionally disturbed, clouded. Because this whole process of how emotions hijack the mind is even described in the Bhagavad Gita. Now this is what I want to point out. The Bhagavad Gita is a popular spiritual, advice to society. This was the way this knowledge was translated into society. Vishayan dhyayada pumsa sangasteshu bajayade. Sangat sanjayade kama kamat krodho vijayade. Krodhat bhavadi sammoha sammohat smriti vibhrama. Smriti bhramshat buddhi nasho buddhi nashat pranashyati. I was reading the Gita carefully, and one clear message that I got is that buddhau sharanam anvicha kripana phala hedava. Seek refuge in buddhi. Most of the times Krishna has told Arjuna to seek refuge in his own intelligence, not in Krishna. This is so fascinating. So it is actually a beautiful psychological counseling. This whole concept of Indian psychology was brought into the people through the medium of Bhagavad Gita in such a profound way. He says, buddhi yukto jaha adiha ubhe sukrita duskrite. Only if you use your intelligence or buddhi, you can eliminate or discriminate between sukrita and duskrita. Not in any other way. Iti guhyatamam shastram edad uktam mayanakha edad buddhva buddhiman syat. Krita krityascha bharata. This is so profound. Edad buddhva, knowing this, become a buddhiman so that krita kritya. Krita kritya means having done what should have been done. And that is why at the end Krishna tells, etavadeva vijnanam yathechasi tatha kuru. Do whatever you want. Because the whole idea is empowering the individual to awaken his or her own faculty of the buddhi and use that to. And the connection to your inner self is what awakens your buddhi. Because if you are connected to the external indriyas, then you are in an emotional turbulence. So that is the whole idea of the chariot, the five sense organs, and atmanam radhinam vidhi chariram radhamevatu indriyani hayanyahu vishayamsteshu gocharan. So buddhim tu saradhim vidhi mana pragrahamevatu. So with the mind we have to control the sense organs and connect to the buddhi, which is the inner light in your own deeper self. And this is the idea of how prajna is cultivated. So I wanted to, we are looking at translational models. I mean, this has been wrongly labeled as religious, but once we deconstruct that, you can see this is how this whole mental health concept now comes into society. You have that image of Krishna and Arjuna, you know, in the chariot. This is a profound metaphor. In fact, in Ayurveda, this whole Bhagavad Gita metaphor is used to describe a mentally ill person, because Vagbhada and Charaka also, I think, uses the same terminology. Bhrashta Sarade Vadhrata. The mentally ill person is like a chariot without a charioteer. So this is a very profound and multidimensional model of the human mind and human health. Then there are certain other interesting ideas about mental health. Maitri. Maitri is a sign of mental health. And what is Maitri? We can say that it is friendship and healthy social relationships. But that's a technical definition of Maitri. Pararthesu Swartha Buddhi. Pararthesu Swartha Buddhi. Being selfish for others, not for yourself. This is the idea of Maitri. And this is the absolute social commitment. You know, absolute expression of philanthropy. It's not by giving, hundreds and billions of dollars that we define a philanthropic mind. A philanthropic mind is a mind that is thinking for the other person as you would think for yourself. So this is a friend. So when we say friendship, friend means somebody with whom you spend some time. That's not the idea. Who gives you company. The definition is that somebody who thinks for you, thinks for your good. That is the concept of Maitri. And then we have Karunya or Anukampa. You know, these are all characteristics which describe different levels of mental health, one leading to the other. So if you have emotional control, if you have, you know, prajna, if you have balance of tridoshas and trigunas, then all these qualities will unfold one after the other. And you become a person who is, you know, completely transformed and can contribute to society through what we call as hitamayu and sukhamayu. So this is integrated into our concept of health. So Karunya or Anukampa is that the feeling, I mean, one is at the intellectual level, Maitri is that you are thinking, but Karunya means you're also feeling. This is so beautiful that we brought both things together. And in fact, my own guru used to say that, you know, you need both, knowledge as well as compassion to be helpful. I mean, Amma would tell a story of a fish that was jumping from a river. So many fishes do that. They just jump out of the water and then fall back. A monkey was looking at it from the shore. And suddenly he felt a lot of compassion. My God, the fish is trying to come out of the water, but it's unable to. So let me help. And so with a lot of effort, the monkey catches the fish and puts it on the shore. And in a few minutes, the fish just dies. And the monkey is so sad. The monkey really wanted to help the fish. So Amma says that, it's not enough that you just have compassion or feeling. You must also have the knowledge. If you do not have the knowledge, you cannot help. So this is so beautiful that it's put so simply, but Maitri and Karunya should come together. If you have just Maitri, in fact, sometimes Maitri is better even if you don't have Karunya. Like a doctor, for example, if he gets overwhelmed with emotion, then he cannot help the person. Sometimes it's good that the doctor is not, you know, emotionally neutral, because then he can just focus on his work. That's why even a good doctor cannot work on their own, you know, near and dear ones because of this conflict. So this idea of Maitri, Anukampa, and Anukampa is also a beautiful word to explain empathy. Anukampa means that, you know, you are also that reverberation of another person's sorrow. You reverberate along with it. I mean, you become one with the sorrow of that person. So this is a very interesting idea of mental health. You know, a lot of problems in modern society happens because, I mean, we don't have these qualities. This creates a lot of stress and tensions in especially corporate environments. I think that is where these concepts need to be brought into. And then comes the mental balance or ability to cope, which we call as sampat vipatsu ekamanaha. That is, being able to cope with the adverse situations in life. Otherwise, you cannot be mentally healthy. And then finally, self-actualization. So only when all these things, self-actualization means redefining and recreating your own self, going deeper and deeper, and deeper into your own personality, the ability to recreate and come back with a new, because we are also recreating ourselves as we grow. I mean, we may, deep inside, our experiences are helping us to reshape our own personalities. The personality that comes back rejuvenated is able to better cope with the situations in life and move forward. So unless that reconstruction of your inner self happens, I mean, you cannot move forward in life. So this ability is also a very important sign of mental health. So this I have put into a flow chart here, which shows how these multidimensional aspects and how mental health is achievable only if we bring all these things together. And this is a model of mental health that Ayurveda offers. To repeat it again, the balance of the trigunas and the tridoshas, without which your prajna cannot be awakened. And strengthening that prajna with emotional stability. And once this is there, then you have maitri and karunya, based on which you are able to better cope with the problems in your life and then reconstruct and self-actualize, so that you elevate yourself. This reconstruction of your personality, this was a sign of samskara. And that is why the Brahmin culture is expanded. Brahma means to expand. So the one whose mind has expanded becomes a Brahmin. And he's, by that reconstruction of his own personality, he's Dvija. He's a twice born. So that reconstruction of your, so that is, this is proof that you, nobody can be a Brahmin by birth. Because it is the second birth that makes you a Brahmin. It is when you reconstruct yourself in good mental health that you become an expanded personality called Brahmin, who can help and think for the world. And that is the whole idea of mental health. So I think all these concepts needs to be deconstructed. And if you just follow the Sanskrit, it's very straightforward. If you use translations, if you say Brahmin Pandit, then it's gone. Or priest, most common translation of Brahmin is priest. But that is just a conventional meaning. The word Brahma means to brihvardhane, to expand and to recreate. So the, we look at these concepts one by one. The balance of the trigunas, the vulnerabilities of the mind. Rajas stimulates activity, thought and motivation. So if you don't have any rajas, you cannot act. So it's important. If you don't have rajas, you cannot think. And if you don't have rajas, you will not be motivated. So motivation, thought and action, these are the three ways in which rajas, expresses through us. But if rajas is not kept in check, it can lead to thought diarrhea, too much of thinking, irritability and aggression. This is the dangerous part of rajas. So there is actually a possibility. This is what I am actually working on, to develop a scale with which we can measure the rajas. So self-administered scale also. You can know at what level of rajas you are. And there is a warning sign. If you see these signs, it means your rajas is going out of control. And then what are the solutions that you can apply in your life to keep it under check? So this is a very good tool, a Triguna assessment scale, which we are now doing to just classify individuals into Sattvic, Rajasic or Tamasic. I think that doesn't make sense. We need a dynamic scale through which people can be taught how to keep their mind more and more sattvic. This is what will have a transforming effect on society. So you must know, I must know, I must become aware that my rajas is going out of balance. I must become aware that my tamas, so tamas, the ability to withdraw from activity, which is so important. If you have no tamas, you cannot sleep, you cannot rest, and you cannot, recover from any experience. You cannot renew yourself if you did not have tamas. But can lead to lethargy, procrastination, loss of motivation, depression. So from motivation to violence, we have a scale, a continuum, which can be clearly marked and can be identified in individuals. This is an area which I think it's a work in progress, but this is a tool that we have to collectively develop and help people, so keep their gunas in balance, then definitely this is the, so in Ayurveda also, that is why he says, in Acharya Rasayana, Satyavadina Makrodha Madhyatma Pravadendriyam, these are all the concepts of how to bring this dominance of the Sattvaguna in your mind. And Sattvaguna makes one centered in harmony with the self, and it keeps Rajas and Tamas within acceptable limits. I mean, you are centered, you are responsive. The big change here, what Ayurveda talks is about being reactive and responsive, being reflexive rather than being reactive. So Rajas and Tamas puts you into a reactive mode. You react to situations. Whereas in Sattva, you are responding. That's the only difference. You are witnessing. You are seeing the event and giving an appropriate response. That's the only thing that we can do, actually. So that is why Sattva Guna needs to be in the center. And this is the first concept of mental health in which Ayurveda teaches us how to move from a reactive mode to a responsive mode.